Hello, this is Cynthia Sue Larson with realityshifters.com, and today I'd like to talk with you about something that I find particularly interesting, and it's the subject of quantum teleportation and reality shifts. The reason I put these two subjects together is that, well, you'll see when I go through the history, the science, and some personal experiences that all tie it together. First, I'd like to start with the science. And just in the past 12 months, there has been some remarkable leaps forward, really. There's no other way to put it, in the field of quantum physics, having to do with teleporting macroscopic objects that you could actually see and touch and hold in your hand. In this case, rubidium molecules teleported a distance of 150 meters. And this work was done in China. What's so exciting about it, for me personally, is that this is literally historic scientific research being done right in our time, and it literally is showing us that some of the things that we see on the quantum level are not confined purely to the quantum level. This is something that some of us who have experienced reality shifts have suspected for a long time, but I am just thrilled to see that some of the work being done right now is giving us very solid evidence and, in fact, repeatable scientific experimental evidence that shows that teleportation, even though we call it quantum teleportation because it's working with some of the spooky action at a distance, having to do with entanglement, having to do with teleportation, and having to do with just having this sort of a superposition of states, and all of that's a little bit detailed right now. But I want you just to think about the fact that if you are able to witness yourself and be in that laboratory with those scientists who are teleporting something that you could actually see and touch and hold in your hand over 150 meters away, that's pretty extraordinary. And I mentioned that I'll talk about some history. One more thing in the science realm before I move into history, make it quick. This is the work of another scientist, Dr. Luca Turin, of the Fleming Institute in Greece. This is, right now, the only person that I know that's just out there making a solid stand for this case that in our noses, right here, when we breathe, when we smell, we are probably working with quantum teleportation there as well. And he makes a very solid case that so far no one has been able to disprove, having to do with the fact that the atoms sulfur and hydrogen, for example, can be put together in a molecule lots of different ways. In the past, when it comes to olfactory perception and the sense of smell, scientists believed that the chemicals themselves had receptors that matched so that when a molecule came along, it exactly fit in the nose, and that's what gave us the sense of smell. Well, what's so clever about Dr. Luca Turin's observation is that he can take these molecules, mix the atoms up all sorts of every which way, just lots of combinations. What we would expect is that then it would be very difficult for, if not impossible, for a person to say that all of these different molecules all smell like, in this case, rotten eggs. So that would be the assumption. What actually happens, and you'll be amazed to hear this as well, is that when we smell something, we are smelling the hydrogen and the sulfur together, regardless of how those molecules were put together. And you may wonder, well, how does that work? If the receptor model of just, you know, the blocks fit together because you put a square peg in a square hole, therefore that's how the smell comes through, what else could be happening? And Dr. Turin is proposing that actually, very likely, we have quantum teleportation happening in our noses so that you can get something that otherwise does not fit exactly. There's no way to have that many receptors in our nose, but it doesn't matter because we can, it's just like fixing, you know, twiddling with a Rubik's Cube until everything lines up. That's what's going on, quite likely, and no one's disproven it yet. Now to get to the history, and this is very exciting as well. I think you'll love it. Well, the earliest known story of human teleportation goes back to October 24, 1593, when there was a gentleman, Gil Perez. He was working in the Philippines as a palace guard, and he was just on duty. At some point, he got tired, leaned up against a wall, apparently, according to his own account, which seems quite likely, and then he was immediately observed no longer in the Philippines, but all the way, miles away, 9,000 miles away, in Mexico City. And he was observed there, and he was there in the Plaza Mayor, when he arrived, he was still wearing the uniform of the guards from the Philippines, and people were asking him what's going on, and he had just received news back in the Philippines that earlier that same day, the governor had died, and this would be, let's see the name of the governor, Gomez Perez Damarinas. And this was a person of importance at that time to Gil Perez because he worked for him. You know, this would be someone that he was a direct, you know, he was from Spain and definitely, you know, in charge of that area in the Philippines. But now he had been killed by pirates. This news was confirmed when ships reached Mexico. It takes a month or two for that to happen back in 1593. And that's when everyone was just so amazed by this story. There are other accounts as well of teleportation, many cases. Another one that was well documented occurred in 1904 in Italy, and Signor Pansini was a building contractor who had a couple of young boys, and some amazing things happened with those boys where they would teleport instantaneously 30 miles away at a time when there's no logical way they could have gotten so far so fast. So that's another excellent example of teleportation on a human scale. You may wonder why I'm mentioning these stories. And the reason is, when you think about teleportation as being something that's no longer confined to the quantum realm, but something that could be happening and probably is happening all the time in everything from photosynthesis of the plants around us. We've got a tree right here. And photosynthesis is one of the most remarkable processes in the world to convert sunlight into something that can give energy to a tree. And then to the smell in our nose, also to the way birds can flock together and sense the direction they're going. But I'd like to also tell you a personal account of a teleportation story that I myself experienced, and that went back to the year 2007. In the month of September, I was indoors in Concord, California, working in a holistic expo, daydreaming, wishing I was elsewhere, and thinking, what a beautiful day. I would just love to be outside. My mind wandered, and I was in a very beautiful, blissful daydream state. High energy also, just feeling energized, not at all depressed or sad, just super vibrant. And a few days later, I got an email from a friend of mine, Katrina Dreamer. She's a blogger, and she writes beautiful, beautiful blog posts, which I think you'd love to check out. And she told me this amazing story. And in her experience, well, first she asked me a question. You know, were you by any chance on Solano Avenue in the city of Albany this particular day, which was September 30th, 2007? And I wrote back and said, yes, I was. Well, actually, wait a minute. I was thinking of being there. I was just there in a daydream. And she said, because I saw you there, and I knew that was a little bit strange because I remembered that you were scheduled to appear at a holistic expo that same day in Concord. And I wrote back and said, yes, that's amazing, because I was daydreaming of being there. So in some way, it seems like I did, in fact, teleport there, some version of myself. This is possibly also a bilocation situation. And like I said, when you get to the quantum realm, you see superposition of states. You see things that look like sometimes being in two places at once. When you think about all the possibilities, it gets pretty exciting and pretty amazing. So until next time, this is Cynthia Sue Larson. Keep asking, how good can it get?